mandibular molar is one of the largest molar teeth which you see in the human dentition. Even though it's large, the crown to root ratio is almost half. The crown length is just 7.5 millimeters and the root length is 14 millimeters. It is definitely the largest tooth mesiodistally in the oral cavity. Mesiodistally, the maximum width measures around 11 millimeters. Contrastingly, cervix is around 1.5 to 2 millimeters shorter, and we will keep it as 9 millimeters cervically. The whole tooth itself has 5 cusps. So there will be 5 cusps on the occlusal aspect, and there will be 2 roots, one mesial and one distal. As we carve for all the other previous teeth, we will mark the crown length on all the aspects, root length along with the midlines. When it comes to marking the mesiodistal dimension of the crown, at the cervix it's 9 millimeters, so we'll keep it at 4.5 on either side. The maximum width has to be marked at 2 different levels. The distal contact area is at the middle of the middle third, so initially we draw 2 lines so that we divide the buccal aspect into cervical, middle and the occlusal third. At the middle of the middle third, we mark a point distally. At the junction of middle and occlusal third, we mark a point mesially. Then we mark around 5.5 millimeters on either side. Then nearly comes to the end of the wax block on either side. Then join these two lines. Once we do this, we just mark 2 straight lines, slightly convergent occlusally. This width can be marked as just a millimeter or a millimeter and a half. Once you get this occlusal outline, you can make out that the crown is roughly trapezoidal. We have 2 non-parallel sides which represent the mesial and the distal. The 2 parallel sides are represented by the cervical and the occlusal, the cervical being the shorter one. Once we do this, we cut the wax. We have to make sure that we cut throughout so that the same cut is observed from the lingual aspect also. Do the same on the opposite side. This was the mesial. This was the distal portion. Distally, the contact is in the middle of middle third. Make sure you get an acute angle at the neck portion, like you can see from the side. Do the same for the distal aspect also. Now you can appreciate the trapezoidal shape, and you can make out the 2 contact areas distinctly at different levels. After this, we turn around to the mesial or the distal aspect, whichever is more convenient. Important points to be kept in mind would be the crest of curvatures. Buccally, the crest of curvature is in the cervical third. So in the middle of the cervical third, you'll have the buccal crest of curvature. Lingually, it is in the middle of the middle third. The characteristic feature of a mandibular posterior teeth is the crown appears to be tilted more lingually compared to the root base, and it is the same character with all the premolars as well as the molars. So step 1, we will be marking the labiolingual width from the cervix as well as the maximum. The cervical labiolingual dimension is around 9 millimeters, same as that of the buccal aspect. So we mark 4.5 on either side. The maximum width is at two different levels. So we mark the midline again. After we mark the midline, lingually at the middle of middle third, we have to mark around 5 millimeters. The maximum issue distal width is 10.5 millimeters. So we mark 5 lingually at the middle of middle third, and another 5 to 5.5 buccally at the junction of cervical and middle third. Once we do this, we mark 3 millimeters on either side at the occlusal level. So we can keep it from the occlusal aspect. So we mark 3 millimeters. Another 3 millimeters. One and two. Once we do this, we join the lines. We cut along these drawn lines. Lingually, when you cut the slope, you can make out a single line developing. This line should be in the middle of middle third. And from this line, cervically, you have to remove wax. Buccally do the same. You can see this line developing, that should be in the cervical third. If you look at the whole tooth, you can make out that the lingual crest of curvature is in the middle, buccal crest of curvature is in the cervical third. This is from the distal aspect. Same way you can make it out from the mesial aspect also. Once the buccal and the mesial aspects have been carved from the occlusal aspect, we need to make out a small rectangular or a quadrilateral surface on the top, and you can make out that parts of the labial and the lingual surfaces can be made out with parts of the mesial and the distal. You have two outlines here, the one inner outline which is going to represent your final cusp locations, and the outer outline is going to represent your occlusal outline. The occlusal outline, as suggested, is roughly hexagonal in shape. The important character about the occlusal aspect is the distal cusp is more lingually placed compared to the buccal cusps. So you should have, this is the mesial surface, this is the distal surface. Distally, there will be a small distal cusp in this location, and where the mesiobuccal and the distal cusps are separated, there should be a slight concavity in that particular location. The whole crown converges lingually as well as distally. So you should make sure that the occlusal outline should have this characteristic. We start by rounding off the line angles on all the sides. Once the line angles are rounded, use the concave surface of the carver to give a slight concavity on the distal side, like this. When you look at it from the occlusal aspect, you can make out there's a concavity that is developed in this portion. This concavity will automatically give the convergence here. And then you have rounding of the lingual aspect followed by convergence lingually. You have to make sure that the whole tooth is mesiodistally wider than the labiolingual dimension. The rough occlusal outline should give you an idea of which is the side of the particular tooth. As you can make out, this is the distal portion. So the whole molar tooth becomes the left side molar. So we are carving the left hand side molar tooth. When we look at the occlusal aspect, you should divide it equally into the buccal segment and the lingual segment. The lingual segment has two cusps which are roughly the same size, but the mesiolingual cusp will be slightly larger than the distolingual cusp. The buccal segment has three cusps, two almost equal cusps that are the buccal cusps, again the mesiobuccal being slightly larger, followed by the distal cusp which is the smallest of all the five cusps. How do we divide the whole segmentation? The buccal segment has three cusps as stated earlier, and this is the midline where the bifurcation of the root is going to be finally located. The bifurcation is located 3 millimeters below the cervix. When you look at the whole tooth, the three cusps buccally are divided as mesiobuccal, distobuccal and the distal by two grooves. The two grooves are namely the mesiobuccal groove and the distobuccal groove. The mesiobuccal groove is slightly mesially located to the midline, that is the level of bifurcation. So 1 millimeter mesial to the midline, you draw a line like this, and this is roughly parallel and it stops at the middle of the cervico-occlusal width. The distobuccal groove on the other hand travels more towards the distal direction and it roughly ends at the distobuccal line angle at the cervical third. Once you mark a point 1 millimeter, you get almost the width of the mesiobuccal cusp. The same width should be given here, and from the occlusal aspect you draw a line which travels more distally and ends at the cervical portion. This will be roughly the location of the distobuccal groove. Once done, you turn around to the occlusal aspect and you draw these two lines which you have already marked from the buccal aspect. To carve the lingual portion, the lingual cusp is divided into two. So you mark a point roughly in the middle of the two lines which you drew buccally and mark a line. So these three lines are going to be the representative developmental grooves from the occlusal aspect, and the one midline is going to be the central groove which is finally going to be carved. To carve the occlusal aspect, we mark a midline first followed by two parallel lines buccally and lingually. Once this is done, you give a small V-shaped notch. It should not be very deep. So you remove this extra wax. Should be done in such a way that you should be able to make out a V-shaped notch from the mesial as well as the distal aspect. So you can make out this V. This should be very shallow, just 0.5 to 1 millimeter in depth. Once done, buccally you have already marked two lines. At these two locations, you slightly remove wax as a small V there. On either side. As you can see from the buccal aspect, you can make out that shallow V-shaped depression. In a mandibular molar, the buccal cusps, the three buccal cusps represent the functional cusp. That means these three buccal cusps are going to occlude with the central fossa of the maxillary first molar. That is the reason these three teeth are the maximum attrited dentition. And attrition means they are roughly flat, they do not form any angle. Among the three cusps, the distal cusp is the sharpest, and the other two are roughly flat. The same is not true with the lingual cusp. The lingual cusps are sharp, well developed, and they also form an angle of around 100 degrees at the cusp slope. The junction between the two slopes at the groove is more than 100 degrees. The distal slope of the mesiolingual cusp and the mesial slope of the distolingual cusp, the angle is formed which is more than 100 degrees. So you initially draw a line and then cut a V-shaped notch again from the lingual aspect. So you roughly know where the final five cusps are going to be. 1, 2 lingual cusps. This is the mesiolingual, distolingual, mesiobuccal, distobuccal and the distal cusps. This is going to be your final configuration of your occlusal aspect. The occlusal surface of the molar has a central groove. The central groove starts at the central pit, which roughly is almost mesiodistally centered. From the central pit, the groove travels mesially and distally. Mesially it ends at the mesial fossa, distally it ends at the distal fossa. These are the two triangular fossae that are present on the corners. From the central pit, as the groove travels slightly mesially, it is met by the mesiobuccal groove. Same way, slightly distally, it meets the distobuccal groove. In between those two, you have the lingual groove. The lingual groove crosses over to the lingual surface only for a short duration of just a millimeter or so. To start carving, we have to first carve the triangular ridges. And the triangular ridges of all the cusps, they do not converge at the center, but they are roughly parallel. This makes the central groove little zigzag pattern when you look at it from the occlusal aspect. To start with the first cusp where we carve the triangular ridge, we take the mesiobuccal cusp. From the mesiobuccal cusp tip down towards the central groove, roughly in a parallel direction, we are going to carve a triangular ridge. This is the slope. This is the smaller slope of the Lecron's carver. So you position the carver in this manner. The future marginal ridge is going to be in this location. So you draw a line just inside the marginal ridge. Make sure the cusp tip, the slope and the tip of the carver is in line with the line which you have drawn. So starting from the mesiobuccal cusp tip, make sure the carver's tip follows the line what you have drawn and remove a layer of wax. So you can make out there is a slope that is formed. This is the mesial slope of the triangular ridge of the mesiobuccal cusp. Similarly, you turn around and carve the distal slope of the triangular ridge. So you can make out there is a small triangular ridge that is developed. It has a mesial slope, distal slope, and you can see that a portion of the marginal ridge has started to form. The next step would be to carve the triangular ridge of the mesiolingual cusp. The tip of the mesiolingual cusp's triangular ridge should end slightly more distal to the triangular ridge of the mesiobuccal cusp. To start with, we will carve the mesial slope. So this is how you carve the mesial slope. Remove the excess debris of wax. Now carve the other slope of the cusp. You can make out that the mesiolingual cusp's triangular ridge is slightly more distally placed to that of the mesiobuccal cusp, and you can make out the marginal ridge has almost formed on that side. Once the two triangular ridges of the mesial cusps are done, we'll go on to the middle cusp buccally, that is the distobuccal cusp. The distobuccal cusps triangular ridge also goes parallel to the mesiobuccal cusps triangular ridge, and we just have to reshape the triangular ridge in such a way that the end of the triangular ridge meets at the end point of the lingual groove. So you shape it. So you can make out triangular ridge that is formed, and it is in continuum with the lingual groove. Once done, the next triangular ridge would be the distolingual cusp. The distolingual cusp's triangular ridge has to be carved with precision. Main reason being, the distal cusp is more towards the distal surface than the buccal surface, and the distal marginal ridge is not parallel to the mesial marginal ridge, but it is little more angulated, and angulated in such a way that it faces more lingually. So you have to be very careful in carving the distal slope of the triangular ridge of the distolingual cusp. You will first draw a line just inside the lingual border of the distal marginal ridge. As you can make out, the distal marginal ridge is going to be slightly more angulated. Make sure the cusp tip slope is parallel to the slope of the carver. Then carve the distal slope here. Then turn around. Then you carve the mesial slope. Now you can make out there is a triangular ridge starting from the lingual cusp. Just reshape the lingual cusp, then make out the obtuse angles formed by the lingual cusp. The point where the distal slope of the distolingual cusp and the distal marginal ridge meet, sometimes there may be a developmental depression present in this particular location. So with that, we can carve at the end of the carving. So once this is done, you can just reshape, remove the wax debris from the occlusal aspect. Then the final cusp, which has to be shaped and the carving has to be done for the triangular ridge, is the distal cusp. The distal cusp is slightly shorter than the other two buccal cusps. So step one would be to reduce the height of the distal cusp. Even the distal marginal ridge is slightly towards the cervical line. That is why we are able to see more of the occlusal surface from the distal aspect. So once you reduce it, the tip of the triangular ridge should end distal to the triangular ridge of the distolingual cusp. So you have to be very careful and carve a small triangular ridge. For the distal cusp, so from the occlusal aspect, now you can make out various triangular ridges 1, 2, and 3, mesiobuccal, distobuccal, distal. Lingually, you have the mesiolingual cusp and the distolingual cusp's triangular ridge. If you can appreciate, they are not meeting each other, but they are in between the other two. So it gives the occlusal surface a characteristic zigzag pattern. Once this is done, you can make out that the buccal cusps automatically tend to get a sharp appearance. You just have to round off the buccal cusps. This will automatically make you visualize some amount of the lingual cusps from the buccal aspect. If you keep it perpendicular, you can make out that the tip of the two lingual cusps can be seen from the buccal aspect. This is the mesiobuccal groove, this is the distobuccal groove. When you turn around, you can slightly extend the lingual groove. It just extends 1 to 2 millimeters, not deeper. From this aspect, you can make out the three buccal cusps, 1, 2, 3, and the two lingual cusps. You can make out the triangular ridges going down straight towards the central groove, which has a characteristic zigzag pattern. You can make out the concavity on the distal side, which separates the distal cusp and the distobuccal cusp. Looking at the tooth from the buccal aspect, the distobuccal groove starts at the distobuccal line angle and goes mesially to the occlusal surface in between the distal cusp and the distobuccal cusp. The mesiobuccal groove comes down up to the center, cervico-occlusally. Lingually, there is a small lingual groove extending on the lingual surface. Also, from the buccal aspect, mesiodistally, there is a developmental depression in this direction. Mesiodistally, there is a developmental depression at the point where the mesiobuccal groove ends, but above the crest of curvature cervically. So you just have to make a shallow depression here. Once this is done, you can make out that there is slight concavity that develops from the mesial aspect. So when you look at it from the mesial aspect, the buccal outline is initially convex, followed by a slight concavity, which is represented by this particular developmental depression. The mesial marginal ridge is slightly higher than the distal marginal ridge, so you cannot see much of the tooth surface from the mesial surface, but from the distal surface you should be able to see occlusal aspect. So you just round off the distal marginal ridge. Once you round off the marginal ridge, we can make out more of the occlusal surface from the distal aspect. The two cusps lingually should be forming an angle of roughly 100 degrees. Once this is done, the occlusal aspect is smoothened. This finishes with the crown portion. Mandibular molar has two roots, one mesial and a distal. The mesial root starts from the cervical line and slightly gets tapered and curved towards the distal aspect, whereas the distal root is more straight and is always aligned in the distal direction. The level of bifurcation from the cervical line is around 3 millimeters. So step one would be to mark 3 millimeters from the cervical line. And bifurcate the whole of the tooth at that level. We mark kind of parallel lines on the mesial or the distal aspect. And then remove the excess wax from this side throughout the width of the tooth. We do the same with the distal aspect, lingual aspect also. At this particular level, we can appreciate that the crown is slightly lingually tilted. This appearance is mainly because the lingual crest of curvature is more higher placed than the buccal crest of curvature. So it gives an impression that the crown is tilted lingually on the root axis. We remove the excess wax from all the sides so that we do not see any portion of the root from the occlusal aspect. So all this excess is removed. Don't remove too much from the distal aspect. So once you have removed all the excess, next is the level of bifurcation. So you remark the 3 mm point from the cervical line. This is the 3 mm point. This is the distal aspect. So your bifurcation will be in this direction. So you start scraping out wax. From the lingual side, the level of bifurcation is around 4 millimeters. This is mainly an illusion because the lingual cervical line is slightly higher than the buccal cervical line, and this gives an extra added millimeter from the lingual aspect. Once the bifurcation has been achieved, we will be looking at the two roots separately because they have different outlines which has to be carved separately. Let's have a look at the mesial root first. The mesial root tip is roughly centered along the mesiobuccal cusp tip. So here you have the mesiobuccal cusp tip. The mesiobuccal root tip will be at this particular location. The mesial outline goes straight till the junction of middle and cervical third, and from there it tapers down evenly to the cusp tip, whereas the lingual outline is straight till the apical third and middle third junction, and then it curves sharply. So you just have to make the lingual outline of the mesial root straight. At the apical third you will be curving it more buccally, only at the apical third, whereas the labial outline is more or less straight and curves only at the end of the root, and the whole root surface, initially the mesiobuccal root goes little more mesially and then curves sharply distally. So we will be removing excess amount of wax from the apical third. So this triangular piece of wax should be removed. We can make out the distal inclination of the root at the apical third, whereas near the cervix it goes little more mesially and then later on curves, whereas the distal root initially itself it is more in a distal direction. So this is how the distal root will be. As and when it progresses from the first molar to second and third molar, the mesial roots tends to fuse with the distal root. I'll taper the root tip. The distal root tip is also tapered. The level of bifurcation is slightly widened. Round off all the line angles, both the roots. The roots of the mandibular molar are unique. They have developmental depressions on either side of the root. That is, if you take the mesial root, there is a developmental depression on the mesial surface of the mesial root as well as on the distal surface of the mesial root. So overall the cross section will look like an eye. That's why this principle is called as an I-beam principle, which architecturally is supposed to be a very strong cross-sectional architecture. Similarly, on the distal surface, the distal portion of the root also should have a developmental depression extending full length of the root. When you look at the tooth from the buccal aspect, you can make out the distal inclination, make the distal root a little more slender, round off the line angles. Both these roots at this particular level follow a cross section of a triangle. That means the roots are little more slender lingually compared to that of the buccal mesiodistal dimension. So you have to remove little more wax from the lingual bifurcation. So both the sides, you will be making it little more slender. In this fashion, you will be removing little wax. You can make out that more of a surface can be seen from the lingual aspect. The tooth tends to have a developmental depression on the inner surface of these two portions also, which is difficult to carve. All the line angles has to be rounded.